Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Murders That Made Us, How Vigilantes, Hoodlums, Mob Bosses, Serial Killers, and Cult Leaders Built the San Francisco Bay Area, by Bob Calhoun. Narrated by Keith Sellon-Wright. If one must be murdered, it'd be far more satisfactory from many standpoints to be murdered in San Francisco. Russell Krauss, New York Times, August 3, 1947. Introduction. A short history of the ongoing end of San Francisco. San Francisco is over. You missed it. This ain't the summer of love. Punk is dead. Die yuppie scum, die techie scum, fucking hipsters. But San Francisco has always been over. It ended about 20 years before you got here, no matter when that was. If you grew up here, it ended some time before you turned 21, and you had to hear your older sister tell you how you're just tromping through the ruins of the real San Francisco that she was lucky enough to be around for. My mother used to go to El Patio, this jazz club over on Market and South Van Ness in the 1950s. She danced to Perez Prado and the Dorsey Brothers when they blew through town. Bill Graham took it over in 1968 and turned it into the Fillmore West. Grateful Dead and Santana played there, and Allen Ginsberg read poetry from its stage. The hippies took it over and ruined everything, my mother said, lamenting the downfall of El Patio and the San Francisco she knew. She and my dad hightailed it out of the city and moved to Redwood City. There weren't any hoppin' jazz clubs in the burbs, but they did get a swimming pool out of the deal. You had those kinds of options when you were fleeing the city because the rent was too damned low instead of the other way around. But to the baby boomers, the summer of love, with all the brown acid you could OD on and venereal crabs you could catch, was what made San Francisco what it was. And if you missed that, you missed San Francisco. The city was over. Dan White and Jim Jones stuck a fork in it in 1978. It was done. My parents escaped the hippie ruination in the 60s. I returned to the city looking for that sort of thing. I saw dead Kennedys at the farm in the 80s, and I wrestled Macho Sasquatcho in a concrete nightclub in Soma in the 1990s. Not so humble brags, I know. But I still feel like I missed the better, crazier, wilder San Francisco that had been, that I was way too late. This isn't to say that other cities don't inspire the same kind of nostalgia that San Francisco does. Vanishing New York will match every defunct diner and shuttered dive bar that Vanishing SF can throw at you. Chicago also mourns its closed-down watering holes, along with a heartbreaking number of public schools. But San Francisco seems to hold this idea that a more real version of itself existed sometime before you got there, poured into its very concrete and seeping out of the wood of its old Victorians. The city that was is the city that is, inseparable but kept apart by the chasm of time. In Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo, 1958, when Tom Elmore as smarmy shipping magnate Gavin Elster, yes, his name is Gavin, hires Scotty Ferguson, Jimmy Stewart, to tail his wife Madeline, Kim Novak, he tells Ferguson, "The things that spell San Francisco to me are disappearing fast." The mid-20th century San Francisco that Elster bemoans is the city that my mother longed to return to, 10 years before Ken Kesey, Jerry Garcia, and Grace Slick showed up and wrecked the damned El Patio. The city that was is also made seemingly more authentic by its crimes, or who shot who in the Embarcadero, August 1879, as Ferguson's long-suffering gal pal Midge, Barbara Bel Geddes, puts it. And the San Francisco that was, with its criminal past giving it gravitas, becomes a malevolent force in Vertigo, possessing and obsessing Madeline and Ferguson until the film's climax in a centuries-old Mission Adobe. One final thing I have to do, and then I'll be free of the past, Ferguson says as he drives Madeline through redwood trees that have lived on this earth for thousands of years. I have to go back into the past once more, just once more, for the last time. The sad thing for him is that he can't. None of us can. 22 years earlier, the opening title card of MGM's San Francisco, 1936, informed us that San Francisco dreams of the queen city she was, splendid and sensuous, vulgar and magnificent. That city was completely leveled by the 1906 earthquake and the pillars of flame that followed it. In the film, buildings shake apart via special effects that complete a Sodom and Gomorrah narrative. The city we live in today is the one that Clark Gable, Jeanette MacDonald, and Spencer Tracy pledged to rebuild as they marched towards the camera, singing Battle Hymn of the Republic. The final shot of the film shows the smoldering ruins of San Francisco fading into the 1930s-era financial district, a shot Scorsese pays homage to at the end of Gangs of New York, 2002. The total destruction caused by the quake goes a long way towards explaining why San Francisco is a city preoccupied with its own demise. But these musings over vanishing San Francisco predate 1906. Bret Hart, one of early California's great scribes, along with Mark Twain and Ambrose Bierce, tells us you pretty much had to come over on a tall ship with Richard Henry Dana to see the real San Francisco. In Bohemian Days in San Francisco, published in the Saturday Evening Post in 1900, Hart recalls a city of houses with floors made from wooden tobacco crates and roofs that were nothing more than cloth tarps. If you thought, as I did, that things were rough in front of Taqueria Cancun on 18th and Mission in the 1990s, that scene had nothing on the weird stories of disappearing men found afterward embedded in the ooze in which they had fallen and gasped their life away, or that one Sunday when a Chinaman was stoned to death by a crowd of children returning from Sunday school. If you weren't there for that, you're just a goddamn poser. In The Mission Dolores, published in 1863, Hart waxes like the San Francisco Chronicle's A Changing Mission series from 2014, only with more racism. The Mission Dolores is destined to be the last sigh of the native Californian, Hart writes. When the last greaser shall indolently give way to the bustling Yankee, I can imagine he will, like the Moorish king, ascend to one of the mission hills to take his last lingering look at the hilled city. I miss those black-haired women with swaying, unstable busts, Hart writes, speculating on a future San Francisco bereft of Latinas. Guess what, Brett? They're still here, and unfortunately still being pushed out by today's version of bustling Yankees with blockchains filled with crypto. Change itself never seems to change. In August 2015, Jeremy Liebarger, editor of the SF Weekly, invited me to contribute a true crime column for the paper's website. After several weeks of presenting the Bay Area's murders and scandals of the past, I started to see a narrative of the metropolitan region itself through the crimes that were committed here. As I arranged my criminal history of the Bay Area into a loose chronology, I found that I wasn't just telling stories of the prominent citizens who met bad ends, but also about the people you've never heard of, as Jimmy Stewart's Scotty Ferguson says in Vertigo. The assassinations of Chronicle publisher Charles DeYoung, Mayor George Moscone, and Supervisor Harvey Milk are here, side by side with Spanny Lopez, the carnation grower who was hacked up and left behind a Market Street movie theater. The kidnapping of newspaper heiress Patty Hearst or the attempts to assassinate President Ford are only pages from the stories of Leroy Carter Jr., 9-year-old Michael Nguyen, and all the other people you've never heard of who got killed and dumped in Golden Gate Park. There are so many of those that they get their own chapter. There isn't a corner of this city that hasn't been touched by crime. San Francisco was founded by genocidal missionaries and modernized by vigilantes who hung people from the roof of a brick building on Sacramento and California streets. Many of our mayors have been hucksters, and our cops are often corrupt. What Midge, again with the vertigo, calls the juicy stories are intertwined with the histories of art movements, lost neighborhoods, suburban migrations, the struggle for LGBTQ plus rights, the summer of love, and political fortunes. Joan Didion, who's made a pretty good career out of explaining California to New Yorkers, wrote that all narrative was sentimental in her essay, The White Album, a meditation on the 1960s that springs from buying a dress for Manson family member Linda Kasabian. Didion connects the dots between buying a white dress on the morning that JFK was shot to Roman Polanski spilling red wine on it 4 years later. Polanski marries Sharon Tate, who was stabbed to death during the Manson family's murderous raid on her home on August 9, 1969. On July 27, 1970, Didion buys another dress for Kasabian to wear during her testimony on the murders at Sharon Tate Polanski's house on Cielo Drive in Benedict Canyon. Didion also warns, "All connections were equally meaningful and equally senseless." I blow past this admonition here, but can't quite ignore it. As I formed a cohesive narrative from what Didion would call the shifting phantasmagoria of San Francisco's criminal past, I hit upon the awful truth that crime held as much nostalgia for me as the dive bars being torn down for luxury condos. So here is my true crime history of San Francisco. Equal parts revulsion and sentiment, where the city we long to return to has far too many skeletons in its closet. It begins not with shootings on the Embarcadero in 1879, but with a brutal murder on San Bruno Mountain overlooking the bay in 1959. A murder my own mother was once suspected of. Chapter 1. My Mother, the Murder Suspect. My mother, Jackie Calhoun, only talked about the murder sparingly. Her hushed tones when she did stood in sharp contrast to how she spoke of everything else. Tales of a fight at the laundromat over the dryers, or that time the doctor threw a pen at her hypochondriac friend, were retold often and in excruciating detail. My mother loved to gossip, and though the murder was her juiciest story by far, it was different. It was serious. The details of the murder that she told me were muddled in my memory by the names of friends and acquaintances she knew before I was born. From what I remember, a friend of the family's was shot in his truck by some crazy woman he picked up somewhere. He called her either a stupid fool or a stupid bitch, depending on the telling. That my mom could know this little detail didn't make sense because the murder took place in the suburban woods somewhere on the Bay Area Peninsula. But there was one other detail of the murder that really stuck in my mind. My mom spoke of growing suspicion among her clique of suburbanites as the murder investigation dragged on unsolved for months. "You started to suspect everybody, friends, neighbors," she said. "You didn't know who to trust. You wondered who could have done it." I always meant to write an article or even a novel out of all that backyard paranoia, but I never thought of asking my mom to retell the story of the murder until it was too late. She passed away in October 2009 after cancer had shrunk her down to almost nothing. My last conversations with her were about the hallucinations brought on by her steady supply of painkillers, or my pleading with her to drink her damned Ensure. I've never tasted Ensure, but it must be horrible. Elderly people would rather die than drink it. During those final days, I never asked my mom about the murder or about anything else for that matter. I didn't get the story of how she moved to San Francisco from Oklahoma in the 1940s, divorced my dad in the 70s, or that time in the 50s when she went to the Black Cat, a seminal gay bar with my dad and uncle, and all the men hit on them and ignored her. I know these stories well enough to tell you about them, but I only have recollections of her recollections, usually delivered from her favorite chair as she lit a smoke. Details are scant and murky. My dad, Leo Calhoun, is in good health, but he's pushing 80. I asked him about the murder while we were having lunch at a Peruvian restaurant in Redwood City, a once working-class Bay Area suburb that's being gobbled up by Silicon Valley. "Do you remember the murder that my mom used to talk about?" I asked. "I think it happened back when you both lived in the Redwood City hills, or maybe it was South San Francisco. I got the impression it happened out in the woods somewhere, but not too far out there." "August Norrie," he answered, letting the victim's name hang in the air for a while before elaborating. "The murder happened when my mom and dad lived on Gutenberg Street in Crocker, Amazon, not far from where I live today. My dad pronounces it Gutenberg, like a punch in the gut, instead of Gutenberg, like the Bible. August Norrie was dumping some lawn clippings on Mount San Bruno, a hillside covered with eucalyptus trees on the southern edge of San Francisco. Norrie ran into a young woman with a gun. She asked him if he was up for a little target practice. He said yes, not realizing he was the target. She shot him several times for no reason at all. My dad gave me the names and places that I didn't have before, but then he dropped a bomb. You know, your mother was questioned in the murder investigation, he said. She matched the suspect's description. A blonde was seen leaving the scene of the murder in Norrie's car. Your mother was blonde, and we lived next door to the Norries back then. They were looking for someone who was having an affair with him, he added. This was a shock, to say the least. My mother never mentioned being braced by homicide dicks. I'd remember that. Anyone would remember that. I pressed my dad for more details. He didn't really have any. He came home from work one day, and my mom said that she'd been questioned for about an hour or so. Now, when we went to Augie's memorial on Mission Street, you could see binoculars or camera lenses being poked through the blinds of the office across the street from the funeral home, my dad recalled. They were watching everyone. Details were now less scant, but maybe even murkier. I put my skills as a researcher and journalist to piecing together the story of the murder the way I should have when my mom was still alive. I dug through online newspaper archives, yellowing clipping files kept by local historical societies, and aging spools of microfilm in the hopes that I'd be able to figure out why my mom chose to soft-pedal this story. August Norrie had an Aeroflin mustache and a mess of dark, slicked-back hair in the one headshot I could find of him that kept cropping up on lurid crime websites. He was a former Arthur Murray dance instructor and a one-time minor league pitching prospect. He had all kinds of trick pitches, my dad recalled during a later phone conversation, but he couldn't get the major league hitters out with his fastball. After failing in a tryout with the San Francisco Seals, Norrie became a self-employed gardener, mowing lawns at the Lake Merced Golf Club not far from his home in Daly City, which he shared with his new bride, Darlene. On Monday, February 2nd, 1959, Norrie made the papers in the worst possible way when his bullet-torn, blood-spattered automobile was found abandoned on a lonely lover's lane, according to the San Mateo Times. The car was ditched on the 300 block of Peoria Street in Daly City, 8 blocks from my parents' house. The next day, the San Mateo Times headline blared, "Police hunt blonde in multiple shot murder," with the kind of overwhelming typeface usually reserved for things like the bombing of Pearl Harbor. Crowding the paper's masthead into a corner was a gruesome photo of Norrie's corpse lying in a patch of weeds on the downward slope of Mount San Bruno. A bullet wound is clearly visible in Norrie's cheek, even with the low-resolution reproduction. In the lower right-hand corner, way below the fold, a much smaller headline reads, "Trio of rock and roll fame die in crash." August Norrie almost pushed the deaths of Buddy Holly, Richie Valens, and the Big Bopper, the day the music died, to page 5. Norrie was shot 18 times with a .38 special, a six-shooter. That means the killer emptied the revolver once, reloaded, kept shooting, and reloaded again. On the day of the shooting, a good-looking blonde driving a car that looked like Norrie's almost ran over a 12-year-old kid playing on the hillside. We have information that there was another woman involved in Nori's life, San Mateo County Sheriff L. Whitmore told reporters. Whitmore added that the blonde woman might be married, and there was the remote possibility that Nori was slain by an avenging husband. While the eyewitness description led the police to my mother, they were also figuring my dad for the crime. Nori was murdered on Sunday and found on Monday. On Tuesday, Sheriff Whitmore and Daly City Police questioned Darlene Nori for several hours. August was 28. Darlene was 20. They had been married for only 18 months. The couple was expecting their first child. Police inspectors found a paperback on child rearing titled The First Year of Life in the back seat of Nori's blood-soaked sedan. The whole thing was incredibly sad. Sheriff's inspectors Eugene Stewart and William Ridenour continued the search for the blonde revenge slayer. On Wednesday, February 4th, 1959, they questioned a 19-year-old blonde waitress who was found drunk in a Daly City residence that wasn't her own. They cleared the drunken waitress and then questioned more blondes. One of those blondes was Jacqueline Faye Calhoun, age 24. 10 years later, she'd be my mother. Did my mom offer Stewart and Ridenour coffee when they came knocking on her door? Was she cordial or hostile? Either way, she must have been scared, probably more scared than she'd ever been in her life, before or since, except maybe when she was diagnosed with cancer. My older sister, Danielle, was just 7 months old at the time. Had my mom put her down for a nap, or did she cry through the entire interview, providing my mom with a living, screaming alibi? Either way, my sister's existence probably helped cross my mom off the suspect list. The wood-shingled house on Guttenberg Street where my mother was interrogated straddles the border between the Daly City suburbs and San Francisco's Crocker Amazon neighborhood. My grandmother lived there with my mom while my dad was away in the Air Force. When my dad got back from fixing radios in South Korea in 1957, my grandmother moved to downtown San Francisco to party down at El Patio. You go, Grandma. My grandmother on my father's side lived just up the block in a house that now has in front of it a broken-down truck so old that it looks like she left it there. Growing up with divorce and custody battles, I find it hard to imagine both sides of my family ever being so close. A block away, Guttenberg dead ends at the incline of the mountain where Nori became a human target. Up the street from my parents lived Charles and Rose Nori, August's parents. Charles Nori was a hard-looking man with an uneven bowl haircut. He was a union beer bottler and coach of the minor league baseball team that August pitched for. My dad was a bat boy with the team in the 1940s and even traveled with the team for a game at San Quentin. My mother's younger brother, Dan Williams, briefly dated the woman who later married Bob Nori, August's younger brother. The histories of my family and the Noris were once intertwined. The murder investigation dragged on for 6 weeks. My mom always made it sound like 6 months because it probably felt that way. The killer was finally announced with more banner headlines on April 16, 1959. Her name was Rosemarie Diane Bjorklund. Her friends called her Penny. Blonde and 18, she lived in her parents' house on Oliver Street in Daly City, 4 blocks parallel to the houses on Guttenberg Street. The inspectors probably passed by her block on their way to grill my mother. The sheriffs tracked her down through the cheap homemade bullets she used, called wad cutters. She bought them from an auto mechanic out in Colma, the Bay Area's suburban necropolis. The mechanic tried to tell the cops that a box of bullets had been stolen out of his car. The cops leaned on him. His story fell apart. He gave up Penny. She was arrested on April 14th, a Tuesday. Sheriff Whitmore sweet-talked a confession out of her at a quiet family restaurant in San Carlos called the Doll House. Penny had the meatloaf with strawberry shortcake for dessert. For about a year or a year and a half, I've had the urge to kill someone, she said. I wanted to see if I could commit a murder and not have it on my conscience. She could. I've felt better ever since I killed him, she confessed. It's like a burden has been lifted off of me. The papers dubbed her with names worthy of a pulp fiction villain. She was the urge killer or the blonde murderess. The story was strange enough to get picked up by papers as far away as Moberly, Missouri and Pottstown, Pennsylvania. The San Francisco Chronicle devoted nearly a full-page spread to a celebrity-style profile of Bjorklund with glamour shots flanked by lingerie ads. The Times Tribune out of Palo Alto called her plump and pretty. Sometime after her confession, law enforcement officials drove Bjorklund to the same hillside where she obliterated Nori so she could reenact the crime. Inspector Stewart filmed Bjorklund as she pretended to shoot an imaginary version of Nori. According to several newspaper accounts, Bjorklund told sheriffs that Nori called her a stupid fool after she pumped the first shot into his gut, although the examiner quoted her as saying, stupid, dash, 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 lending validity to both of my mom's versions of events. Bjorklund hadn't arranged to meet with Nori on the day of the murder, but they did know each other. About a month before the murder, Penny found Nori dumping lawn clippings on the hill where she later killed him. He took her to a drive-thru burger joint before returning her home. She gave him her phone number. He never called her. Nori didn't try anything with Penny either time he met her, but he was playing it real close to the line. After months of generating headlines while awaiting trial, Penny Bjorklund was found guilty of first-degree murder and sentenced to life in prison on August 6, 1959. This was a willful, wanton killing, Superior Court Judge Frank B. Bloom declared. Bjorklund served just 7 years of her sentence before being released and fading into obscurity. At 25 years old, she was still young. She might have gone on to marry, have kids. A public figure page on Facebook, that likely isn't maintained by her, has 69 likes, with people leaving comments on how they'd love to meet her. About a week after my mother died, I was going through voicemails. There was one from her asking when I was coming to see her. She sounded so weak. I had to crank the volume just to make out what she was saying. I hit the delete key without thinking, only to feel a wave of guilt seconds later. That was the last time I would hear my mother's voice, and I erased her just to make space on a hard drive. The newspapers told me the story of August Nori and Penny Bjorklund bathed in hyperbole, but they didn't tell me the story that I was really after. The story of my mother during that police questioning in 1959 and the weeks of suspicion afterwards. I attempted to find that story in court records and police reports, but they had all been purged. Details of death sentences and lives ruined had been tossed in a dumpster somewhere just to make space. Crime isn't usually something we get sentimental over. My dad and my uncle are some of the only people left who remember the murder. I've gotten their stories and unearthed little pieces of family history that I never asked of my mother. I took notes and asked questions this time. I thought the mid-20th century would always be with us, just in the rearview mirror. But it's not anymore. It's getting to be so long ago. Chapter 2. Vigilance. The Hounds. Flakes of gold were found by a New Jersey carpenter in the American River near Sutter's Mill in the Sacramento Valley on January 24, 1848. John Sutter, the Swiss immigrant who owned the mill where he enslaved several Hawaiians, wanted to keep the discovery quiet, but word got out. By 1849, San Francisco's then natural harbor was clogged with ships filled with gold hunters from the eastern United States, Australia, China, Chile, and Peru. The 49ers, as they came to be called, ditched their ships in the bay and hightailed it inland in hopes of striking it rich. Many of the ships were sunk near the shore, covered in sludge, and used to form the highly unstable landfill that the 58-story Millennium Tower is sinking into today. Even with people streaming from the tent cities of San Francisco to the gold fields, the population of the city shot from 400 to 25,000 in 1849. In the power vacuum created by a major port city springing up almost overnight, a gang of military men called the Hounds set themselves up as the city's de facto police force. The Hounds were headquartered in a tent saloon they dubbed Tammany Hall, and often paraded through the muddy streets wearing what the weekly Alta California described as fantastic or ridiculous dresses. As the Hounds became quasi-official, they changed their name to the San Francisco Society of Regulators, but were still little more than a protection racket with drums and bugles. At first, San Francisco's emerging business community was happy to pay the Hounds to shake down recently arrived Chileans, but soon the gang was shaking down the businessmen who were already paying them. With what passed for prominent San Franciscos already fed up with them, the Hounds finally went too far on Sunday, July 15, 1849. After a day of conducting drunken military drills in the East Bay, Hounds leader Samuel Roberts came home and caught Felice Alvarez in her room with Leopold Bleckschmidt and another German man. Roberts believed he had forced Alvarez, a Chilean prostitute, into an exclusive relationship, but she had other ideas. Roberts flew into a rage and dragged Bleckschmidt into the street, beat him unconscious with a club, and slashed his face with his riding spur. Still raging, Roberts then gathered up his regulators and attacked the Chilean encampment. The regulators came down on everyone who spoke Spanish or looked like they might. Men were shot, women were raped, and tents were ransacked. The regulators snatched sacks of gold dust and auctioned off the Chileans' other belongings to passersby on the streets. Several Chileans escaped into the bay on boats. In every direction were heard the cries and shrieks of women and children, mingled with the oaths and demoniac laughter of reckless and impious men, the weekly Alta California reported. Historian Stanton Koblenz later exclaimed the raid was a spectacle of madness, a scene reminiscent of wartime horrors. On the following day, Sam Brannan, W.D.M. Howard, and several other men with streets now named after them held a meeting at Portsmouth Square in what is now Chinatown. They organized a police force and an instant court system to take down the Hounds. Roberts and 20 of his men were arrested and tried, but nothing much came of it beyond the spectacle of the trial itself. Despite being sentenced to 10 years hard labor, most of the Hounds were freed a short time later. The surviving Chileans saw little difference between the vanquished Hounds and those who replaced them. They had a word for these men who took it upon themselves to enforce order, if not the law. They called them vigilantes. The Sydney Ducks. By 1850, San Francisco was built on wooden tobacco crates and lit by oil lamps. Not surprisingly, things burned down. A lot. Instead of seeking rational explanations, the city's newspaper of record drummed up anti-immigrant conspiracy theories. It is a well-known fact that some of the most desperate scoundrels of England who have been serving the Queen in Sydney are in this city and would stick at nothing in the attempt to obtain money by any diabolical crime, the Daily Alta California decried in a January 24, 1850 article blaming Aussies for an alleged wave of incendiarism, or arson, that was blazing through the city. Yes, Aussies. The Alta California continued to hammer on the transported felons of Great Britain for over a year. A February 25, 1851 editorial warned, "Our citizens are at their mercy, and their mercy is such as the wolf gives the lamb." White American xenophobia went beyond the racial lines of today and extended to white people from anywhere but the continental United States. Making the reporting of the time more confusing to the modern reader, the phrase Native Americans referred to white people from the East Coast, and not the Ohlone or Miwok peoples. Australians were often called English or British. Even though only a few Australian immigrants in California were convicts from the Botany Bay penal colony, but dime store novel prose that passed for newspaper reporting back then reported the Aussies had formed a secret society of thugs called the Sydney Ducks. In addition to almost every murder and robbery in Northern California, San Franciscans were led to believe the Sydney Ducks burned down buildings in order to loot the charred wreckage. While this seems like a hard way to rob someone, American citizens who had only been in California for a year or two were moved to combat this imagined secret society by forming an order of their own. After the beating and robbery of Charles J. Jansen in his Montgomery Street store on February 19, 1851, an angry mob of thousands assembled at the plaza in front of City Hall. Police had two Australian men in custody who kind of met the description of the suspect in the case, an escaped convict called English Jim Stewart, who had killed the sheriff of Auburn. The problem was neither man in custody was English Jim. Both were totally innocent. Sam Brannan, a Mormon elder who collected tithe money from Mormon miners without ever passing it along to his church, addressed the mob. Still pissed off about the light sentences handed out to the hounds, Brannan didn't care about the guilt or innocence of the accused in this case. Brannan reasoned that even if these Aussies didn't rob Jansen, they had to be guilty of something. I am very much surprised to hear people talk about grand juries or recorders or mayors, Brannan said. I am tired of such talk. These men are murderers, I say, as well as thieves. I know it, and I will die or see them hung by the neck. I want no technicalities, he added, calling for execution without a trial. Such things are devised to shield the guilty. William Tell Coleman, a distant relative of George Washington, blessed with the handsomeness of Daniel Day-Lewis in Last of the Mohicans, managed to calm the crowd down from instant executions. He was still A-OK with foregoing due process, just as long as everyone was dignified and organized about it. The resulting show trial ended up with a hung jury, even without the meddlesome interference of defense attorneys. Enraged over so many jurors voting for acquittal, the mob bum-rushed the courthouse to get the prisoners. Benches, desks, and railings were broken to pieces, the Alta California reported. The prisoners would certainly have been taken from the room had not the company of Washington guards, who had been parading during the day, rushed in with fixed bayonets and mounting the desks and benches, drove the people away. The two innocent men were left in the custody of the city jail and eventually set free, but the vigilantes pressed forward. By June 1851, the mob of February had organized into the Vigilance Committee, with its own secret signals and motto, "Let justice be done, though the heavens may fall." With the bloodthirsty Brannan at the helm, there would no longer be any trials. Let every honest citizen be a hangman at once. On June 11th, Brannan and his vigilantes were set to hang John Jenkins from the flagpole in Portsmouth Square, given to the city by the people of Portland, Oregon. Unlike the men mistaken for English Jim, Jenkins had been caught fleeing a robbery, so his guilt was unambiguous. However, the vigilantes had opposition by this time. State Senator David Colbreth Broderick, a political fixer who made his fortune by selling $10 gold coins cast from $8 worth of gold, returned from Sacramento and was shocked to find what San Francisco had become. He went to the scene of the impending execution, flanked by a team of his loyal henchmen. With the rope around Jenkins's neck, Broderick and his men grabbed onto Jenkins to try and wrest him free, while Brannan and his men pulled at the other end of the rope in a macabre tug of war. Fighting for due process, Broderick's men were soon joined by actual city police and some concerned Australians, but there were too many angry men on the other side. "A long pull and a strong pull and a pull together," Brannan shouted to encourage the vigilantes. "Let every honest citizen be a hangman at once." Brannan's cheerleading did the trick, and the vigilantes were finally able to hoist Jenkins from an old adobe building, although he had probably already been strangled to death during the struggle. Jenkinson's body dangled over Portsmouth Square for several hours until 7 a.m. when it was cut down. The corpse was taken to the Dead House in City Hall Yard, where it was put on further display and seen by a large number of persons, according to the Alta California. Rarely have we seen a finer, more muscular frame than his. Even with Broderick's bare-knuckled opposition to mob rule, the Vigilance Committee took control of the city's streets. Vigilante patrols turned away ships with immigrants they deemed undesirable. A Frenchman was stomped to death by a mob for speaking with a foreign accent. Buildings and ships were searched with scant provocation. The patrols finally caught English Jim Stewart and hung him without incident from the mast of a ship in the harbor on July 11, 1851. While this seemed like a great victory for the vigilantes at the time, it confirmed that they had tried to hang the wrong men in the first place. Attendance at committee meetings declined after that, and Brannan had trouble collecting membership dues. The group disbanded after just 100 days. Dissolution due to lack of interest was hardly the kind of moral reawakening that Broderick had hoped for. He feared that vigilantism would return to San Francisco, and he was right. But a future vigilance committee would not have Sam Brannan to lead it. Mormon elder Parley P. Pratt arrived in San Francisco around July 1851 and was horrified by Brannan's involvement with the vigilante movement. Pratt disfellowshipped Brannan from the Mormon Church for unchristian-like conduct, neglect of duty, and for combining with lawless assemblies that commit murder and other crimes. Pratt later called Brannan a corrupt and wicked man. Brannan founded the town of Calistoga in 1861 and hoped to make its hot springs into the tourist attraction they would eventually become. He failed at this and was even shot at by townspeople angered over his attempts at gentrification. He later moved to Mexico, battled alcoholism, and died penniless in Escondido, California on May 5, 1889. Josefa. The 4th of July celebrations in Downeyville were extra raucous in 1851. California had just gained statehood on September 9, 1850, so the small mining town at the North Fork of the Yuba River in the Sierras pulled out all the stops. What began with parades and a speech from the state's first governor ended with the lynching of Josefa Segovia, the only hanging of a woman in California state history. After a full day of guzzling mining camp swill, Joe Cannon and a few other drunks were out banging on doors around Downeyville. Cannon, sometimes referred to as Fred or Jack, was well-liked in the mining town and was described in an 1882 history of Plumas, Lassen, and Sierra counties as a Scotchman of magnificent physical strength and Herculean proportions. At some point in the night, Cannon and his pals burst through the door of Josefa Segovia, a proud Mexican woman around 25 years old who lived in her adobe home with her partner or common-law husband, Jose. Jose was out dealing monte at a local gambling house, and Segovia managed to fend off Cannon and his gang before they could rape her. Cannon returned early in the morning. Some accounts say he wanted to apologize, but others say he came back to finish what he started. Either way, Segovia was having none of it. She pulled a bowie knife out from under her blouse and drove the blade clear through Cannon's sternum, killing him instantly. With many miners still celebrating out in the streets, the news of the stabbing went around almost instantly. Segovia took refuge at Craycroft's gambling house. The gamblers who knew her tried to protect her, but the gold diggers threatened to tear down the saloon if they didn't give her up. Segovia was soon dragged out into the street. A show trial was held right there on the spot. A San Franciscan lawyer offered a defense of the woman and stood on a barrel to be heard over the mob. The crowd kicked the barrel from under him, threw him about, and ordered him out of town, William MacDonald told the Oakland Tribune in 1922. MacDonald, then 92, was the last surviving witness to the incident. A doctor who examined Segovia told the crowd that she was 3 months pregnant, but the drunk miners didn't care. The doctor was given just 2 hours to get out of town, McDonald recalled. When the time was up, he was nowhere to be found. The mob sentenced her to death by hanging. Just 4 years earlier, she was a Mexican citizen on Mexican land, but now she had only 2 hours to live while the men born across a continent built a scaffold on the Jersey Bridge over the Yuba River. When Segovia returned to be hung, she did not exhibit the least fear, according to the Daily Alta California. After she climbed the steps of her gallows, Segovia handed her Panama hat to a large miner known as Oregon. When asked if she had anything to say, she said, "Nothing, but I would do the same thing again if so provoked." She also asked that her remains be decently taken care of. She then placed the rope around her own neck and reportedly said, "Adios, señores," before a pistol was fired to signal the men to cut the lashings. Segovia's body dropped 4 feet, but McDonald recalled rumors that her neck didn't snap from the fall. "Her friends might have saved her had they taken her down immediately," McDonald said. The execution of Segovia, without anything even close to due process, was condemned almost immediately. The Daily Alta California, which had been totally in the tank for the vigilantes back in San Francisco, called it a blot upon the history of the state on July 14, 1851. In more recent years, the killing has been placed within a wave of anti-Mexican violence during the gold rush. It is doubtful that Segovia would have been hung had she been white. A plaque dedicated to Segovia's memory near the bridge where she was hung refers to her only as Juanita, even though records of the time give her full name. Adding further desecration, her skull was later stolen from her grave and used in initiation ceremonies by a Sierra City men's club. Segovia's ghost reportedly still haunts the southeast corner of the Jersey Bridge, beckoning to the living on foggy nights. Chapter 3. The Fourth Estate. The Daily Dramatic Chronicle. Early San Francisco had its hoodlums, lynch mobs, and bands of masked men who garroted citizens in the streets. Just as violent a class of people, however, were the city's newspaper publishers who settled libel disputes with hot lead instead of lawyers. On May 15, 1856, just after 5 p.m., the ongoing war of words between James King of William, publisher of the San Francisco Bulletin, and Sunday Times proprietor James P. Casey, ended in a shootout on the corner of Montgomery and Washington Streets in front of a joint called Phil's Oyster Saloon. King of William died from his wounds on May 20th, and Casey was hung by vigilantes from a gallows built out from a roof on Sacramento Street 2 days later. The Second Vigilance Committee and the militias that sprung from the killing of King of William ran the city like a police state and kept on hanging people without trials. However, it disbanded with a big self-congratulatory parade in August 1856, so it provided no deterrent to future acts of publisher-on-publisher violence by the time brothers Gustavus, Charles, and Michael DeYoung launched the Daily Dramatic Chronicle in 1865. The DeYoungs wove a mythology for themselves as being the descendants of French aristocrats from New Orleans. In reality, their father, Michael DeYoung, or D-E-J-O-N-G-H, was a Dutch-Jewish immigrant whose bank failed in the 1830s and who afterwards sold dry goods and made tortoiseshell jewelry. Michael suffered a stroke on a Mississippi River steamboat and died. So the brothers, their mother Amelia, and their 5 sisters moved from St. Louis to San Francisco in 1854. Charles and Michael had learned the newspaper trade as typesetters for Rabbi Julius Ekman's Weekly Gleaner before they launched their Chronicle, a paper that they built up through various degrees of larceny. Unable to afford their own telegraph line, Charles hung around the Western Union office where he learned enough Morse code to horn in on the other paper's wire transmissions. He was there on April 15, 1865, when the news that President Lincoln had been shot came in. Charles rushed back to his office and had three editions of the Cron out on the street with the breaking news hours before their competitors. The other papers never recovered from this early act of info hacking. After rebranding as the Daily Morning Chronicle, Gustavus mysteriously disappeared from the masthead of the family's tabloid in 1868 to be replaced by Charles de Young and Company, the and company being Michael. This was a step up since only Charles's and Gustavus's initials were included on the previous editions. Within its first decade, the paper, now known as the San Francisco Chronicle, boasted, in every sense of the word, the largest circulation of any newspaper west of the Mississippi River, with a winning combination of light gossip and populist takedowns of local movers and shakers. While the Examiner still breaks stories and fills downtown newspaper bins as a free tabloid, the Cron is the undisputed victor of the old newspaper wars that were often as violent as such a martial descriptor would suggest. The Haunted Church. The Emmanuel Baptist Church of Cap Street was cursed from the start. In 1878, the church moved from a rented hall on 22nd and Folsom to more permanent digs at 22nd and Cap. A short time later, the church's first pastor, Reverend Charles Hughes, slashed his own throat with a straight razor. His replacement chose a more common method of suicide and shot himself in the head. Two ministers, two suicides. You'd think that mission residents would have burned the place to the ground after that and called it a day, but the church kept going. The third pastor, Isaac Milton I.M. Callick, was young and politically connected. His father, Isaac Smith I.S. Callick, a minister himself, was a higher-up in the powerful Working Men's Party, which had won almost every seat on the Board of Supervisors on the strength of its really ugly anti-Chinese campaign. Rampant racism made the elder Callick a favorite to win the mayoral race of 1879. But Charles and Michael de Young backed another candidate and started slinging the mud in the Cron's editorial pages. In August 1879, the Cron ran a story severely animadverting upon the character and moral standing of I.S. Callick's dead father. It was on. Callick responded by calling the de Youngs bastard progeny born in the slums and nursed in the lap of a prostitute during a speech at the Metropolitan Hotel. Now, this whole de Young mama was a whore rumor came from an 1874 story in the competing San Francisco Sun. After the Sun ran the rumor, Charles de Young shot it out with the Sun's editor on Market Street. The newspapermen managed to miss each other, but a young boy was shot in the leg. The Chronicle sent the kid $100, and nobody went to prison. 5 years later, Callick not only read from the story, but threatened to reprint it in the Working Men's Party newsletter. On August 23, 1879, Charles de Young went by carriage to the Metropolitan Church where Callick was addressing a gathering. He sent a messenger to get Callick. When Callick emerged from the church, de Young put one shot in his chest and another in his hip, making this a Victorian-era drive-by. As de Young tried to escape, a crowd of people overturned his carriage and pulled him out. He was dreadfully kicked and bruised, according to a wire story. De Young got himself arrested just to survive. The Chronicle had to station armed guards around its offices to keep mobs from trashing the place. "The city is intensely excited," the Deseret News of Salt Lake City reported. "There was never a time when San Francisco was more angry." Callick survived the shooting and won the mayoral race. Charles de Young was released on bail and hid out back east until things died down. But when he came back to San Francisco, he published a pamphlet bashing Callick all over again. De Young just kept at it, until I.M. Callick, the son and pastor of the cursed church, stormed the Cron's offices on April 23, 1880, and shot Charles 5 times, dead. I. M. Kallick was acquitted in March 1881 in a trial where several witnesses were jailed for perjury. Mayor I. S. Kallick was indicted for taking bribes in 1882, but beat the case and served out his full term. Charles DeYoung was downplayed, if not erased entirely, from civic and family histories. His brother Michael took over the paper and became part of a shooting scandal of his own barely 3 years later. Emmanuel Baptist Church hit a gruesome trifecta with 2 suicides and a murder, but even with 3 deaths in less than 3 years, the little church somehow endured. The congregation moved to a new building on Bartlett Street between 22nd and 23rd in 1890, and things stayed quiet for nearly 5 years. When the Reverend John George Gibson took over the church in 1894, his predecessor didn't even have blood on his hands. But the curse came back, and this time it was bloodier than ever. On Saturday, April 13, 1895, a group of church ladies was decorating the pulpit for the next day's lavish Easter Sunday celebrations when one of them found the blood-drenched body of a young woman in a small library storeroom. The girl had been assaulted, and her remains had been cut and hacked, the Spokesman Review of Spokane, Washington, later reported. The victim had also been gagged by the assailant, with a part of her underclothing that was jammed down her throat with a sharp stick. At first, the churchwomen thought the body was 21-year-old Blanche Lamont, a popular member of the congregation who had been missing for 10 days. However, the body was later identified as that of Minnie Williams, a woman who liked the church enough to journey from Alameda by ferry for services. Lamont only stayed missing for another day before a search of the church grounds uncovered her body at the top of a rickety staircase in the church's ominous bell tower. She was stripped of her clothing with her hands clasped upon her breast, according to the Cron. Unlike Williams, Lamont was not mutilated beyond the marks of fingers that had been pressed deep into the tender flesh, and the damage done by 11 days of decomposition. The cursed church could now add a double homicide to its litany of misfortunes. Police quickly arrested W.H.T. Theodore Durant, a medical student and superintendent of Emmanuel Baptist Sunday School, who was identified by several eyewitnesses as the last man seen with both victims. Durant denied killing the 2 women, but Williams's purse was found in Durant's coat during a search of his house. A pawnbroker later testified that Durant had tried to sell him one of Lamont's rings days after her disappearance. Durant's 2-month trial moved a lot of newsprint, as the Cron and Examiner used it to boost readership during the early days of their century-long rivalry. Durant himself received bags of fan mail, much of it from female admirers. While Durant captivated the public, his often contradictory testimony didn't convince the jury, the only audience he really needed to sway. The jury found him guilty in just 22 minutes on November 1, 1895. Durant's final public appearance came in San Quentin's death chamber on January 7, 1896. "I am an innocent man," Durant protested from the gallows at 10:34 a.m. "I bear no animosity toward those who have persecuted me, not even the press of San Francisco, which hounded me to the grave," he added during a 4-minute speech that was described as poorly constructed by the press he excoriated. A few minutes later, Durant was dead. After the drop, Durant did not struggle, the Deseret News reported. In 15 minutes, he was cut down. The neck was broken by the fall. After the murders, mission residents called for the cursed church to be burned to the ground, but again it endured. Even the earthquake of 1906 and the fires that followed failed to take down the building. The church was finally dismantled, plank by plank, in 1915. City College's Mission Center stands on this site today. The Sugar King. Blackmail had been a major part of the Cron's business model since the DeYoung brothers founded it in 1865. Charles and Michael slung mud at the city's well-to-do on the paper's editorial pages, but weren't above taking bribes to squelch a story. And besides, they needed the extra cash to fend off the libel suits that were a regular cost of doing business. But not everyone decided to pay off the DeYoungs or take them to court. After Charles DeYoung was shot to death in the paper's newsroom in 1880, his brother Michael, now going by the tonier M.H. DeYoung, took over the paper without changing its business model. It was only a matter of time before history repeated itself. In 1881, DeYoung set his sights on the Sugar King, Klaus Spreckels, a hard man from Hanover, Germany, who built a trans-Pacific empire with his Hawaiian cane fields and San Franciscan refineries. The Spreckels clan weathered the initial series of Cron exposés that alleged the use of slave labor at the family's Hawaiian plantations. However, when the paper ran a story in November 1884 that accused Spreckels of swindling shareholders in his Hawaiian commercial and sugar company just days before a major...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.